A European Vega rocket is about to launch? Now on kNews. Hi, Lucas here. Welcome to kNews for week 31, 2017, and a big shout out to all my kNews boosters on Patreon. If you also want to help get kNews off the ground, visit patreon.com/kNews. Every single one of you helps. Thanks. Vega will take off at 1:58 UTC as usual from the Guiana Space Center in Kourou. Arianespace's smallest launch vehicle is 30 meters long and has a total of 4 stages, from which the first 3 burn a solid fuel similar to fireworks. Once lit up, they can't be shut down anymore, and what follows is a chain reaction, slowly burning through the inside layers of propellant until, well, until it runs out of it. Burnout of each stage is detected by a sudden drop in thrust, which then triggers the next stage to fire. This continues until it reaches the 4th stage, which can be controlled thrust-wise to inject the payload into the correct orbit. It can compensate for slight variations in the bottom stages, which are always hard to predict perfectly. Up top is of course the payload, which this time consists of 2 satellites. One is a 230 kg microsatellite from Israel called Vegetation and Environment Monitoring on a New Microsatellite, or Venus. The other, slightly bigger, 370 kg OPTSAT 3000 is launched for Italy. I'll come back to these in just a few seconds. To put Vega into perspective, here's some other launch vehicles like Arianespace's Ariane 5 or India's GSLV Mark 3. Yep, Vega is quite small, but just right for smaller payloads. After liftoff, Vega will turn north because Venus and OPTSAT's destination is a sun-synchronous polar orbit. Now, sun-synchronous orbits are really special, and I will cover these in a separate video you can find in the description once it's done. Important to know for now is that OPTSAT's initial orbit has an altitude of 450 km and Venus will fly a little higher at 720 km and an inclination of 98 degrees. The smaller Venus has two kinds of thrusters, from which one uses a two-component hypergolic fuel igniting on contact. Such thrusters are very reliable and used on almost all satellites. More modern ones, however, use so-called ion drives or Hall thrusters, providing thrust by strong electric fields. And of course xenon gas, which gets accelerated out of the back. This is not by coincidence what Venus' second kind of propulsion is, the Israeli Hall effect thruster. I think it's the first of its kind for Israel, but don't quote me on that. Important to know is the goal here is to test them in space and verify the design. Venus' main mission is to fly by every location of interest every 2 days to take high-resolution images of the ground for mentioned environmental purposes. For that, its camera has a giant 1750mm lens with a diameter of 25 cm. This is basically a giant zoom, and it can take images with a resolution of up to 5 meters from the ground, which is quite a lot for such a microsatellite. Now, as you can imagine, clouds are a big problem when taking images from the ground, so the satellite has a neat system to filter them out. By taking 2 pictures right after another, it can create a stereoscopic 3D image similar to what you maybe know from cinemas, just using one instead of 2 cameras. Clouds are much closer to the camera, so Venus can simply delete those pixels and leave them blank. The next time it returns to the same spot, it can then fill those pixels with new information, since the clouds will most likely have vanished or moved to a different place. Like this, the satellite will deliver a complete cloud-free image of each location every 10 days. The other satellite, Opto 3000's purpose, is also imaging, but it's that kind of imaging the military uses for reconnaissance. Yep, it's a spy satellite with a bigger camera and a ground resolution of 1 meter. A 1 meter big pixel doesn't sound that accurate, but it is definitely enough to track ground movement or, for example, find relatively small pirate boats. Now, OPTSAT 3000 is not yet the real deal and will just fill a gap left by a cancelled mission of another spy satellite. I'm not sure if there is a planned replacement yet, but it will be bigger, better, and covered in a future kNews episode. Once Vega's upper stage has released both satellites in different orbits, the mission will be declared a success, and I hope there will be no anomalies. You can of course watch the launch live in just a few hours or minutes from now, depending on how quickly I manage to finish this episode. The link to the livestream is in the info box. Okay, that shall conclude this week's episode, and I hope to see you next one if you like. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.